sanctuary schools to protect immigrants and refugees, the impact that Mike Ilitch had on the city of Detroit, and a major shakeup in the Trump administration involving national security. Stay put. My Week starts right now.
Did you know Gordon Food Service was started by a 23-year-old entrepreneur as a butter and egg delivery business more than a century ago? In 1948, school teacher Gerard Wendell Hayworth borrowed $10,000 from his parents to start a woodworking operation in his family's garage. It's now Hayworth Incorporated. These are just some of the ways Michigan's pioneers started out as small companies with big ideas.
We are business leaders for Michigan. We are committed to making Michigan a top 10 state for jobs, personal income, and a healthy economy. Funding is also provided by Delta.
Hello and welcome to My Week. Thanks for joining us. I'm Stephen Henderson of the Detroit Free Press, holding down the fort while Christy McDonald is under the weather. I'm joined, of course, by Nolan Finley, who is the editorial page editor of the Detroit News. Good to see you, Nolan.
Good to be here.
All right, so big week in the news. It's different. Every week seems to be a big week.
It's a good time to be in the news business.
That's right. Yeah. I think the passing of Mike Ilitch is the thing that caught my attention most this week, and the outpouring. Yesterday, the people who came out for this public viewing downtown, it was just packed. It was like there was a ball game.
Detroit's a grateful city. It's not a, it's a place that is very thankful for people who rise to its aid and assistance, and we appreciate our heroes, I guess, probably more than any other place.
Yeah.
I think that's what you saw over the last week. People recognized the impact that he had on
the stories that people tell. I mean, this was a guy who was around town, and lots of people sort of had encounters with. They'd met him or they'd talked to him, and they really liked him.
Oh, I remember, when he sponsored all these youth pro hockey programs and baseball programs.
People were into it.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. We've got a lot to get to tonight. In light of the president's executive order on immigration, the conversation is growing about creating sanctuary schools for immigrants and refugees. Coming up, we'll talk about these safe havens where students can feel protected and get help if they need it. Also, we're going to take a closer look at the legacy of Mike Ilitch and his love for the city of Detroit and the fallout after the resignation of President Trump's national security advisor. We'll discuss this latest shakeup in the administration. It's all coming up. But we start with the debate over sanctuary schools. Earlier this year, Hamtramck Public Schools took a proactive stance after Donald Trump was elected president. The district adopted a resolution that declared it a safe haven for students, many of whom are Muslim. In our continuing One Detroit coverage, reporter Hassan Khalifa of the Arab American News visited one of Hamtramck's safe schools.
The historic Holbrook Elementary School, built in 1896, sits nestled in the South Side Hamtramck neighborhood. It's filled with students, many with deep ties to Yemen, one of the countries named in President Donald Trump's travel ban. But even before Trump's executive orders targeting immigrants, the school board here had become wary of possible government inquiries into the status of residents and how it could affect the students.
No, it was a surprise to me, and to be frank, just trying to wrap my head around how what he did affects us, I don't know. But even before all that happened, our district lawyer attended a board meeting. We adopted a resolution as a sign of support for the entire community, for our families, and that we will stand up and make sure they are safe and secure.
The Safe Haven resolution cites a Supreme Court ruling that schools can't deny students based on immigration status, and that immigration enforcement authorities are unwelcome on school grounds.
The community will have this, and it'll be translated, and if there's questions, we'll be ready for the questions, and we'll be able to answer the questions properly.
School board member Saleh Hadwan worked on the resolution.
Just taking the steps to keep the community feeling comfortable, safe, and show them why we are in America, and no matter what, we're going to fight.
Hey, kindergarten.
Hullbrook Elementary School Principal Myron Miller supports the resolution. As a politician serves his constituents, Miller says he's there to serve his students.
The board voted on it, it was unanimous, and it's something that was necessary, actually.
Hi.
With the demographics that we have in our city, you have to think that way. You have to think on the lines of what could possibly happen. You can't wait for something to happen. I have 234 students here, of which 220 of them are of Arabic descent, and the majority of that group practice Islam. The things that was presented in the media over the last 8 months to even 18 months from the candidate that is now our president, I mean, it's hurtful to many, especially in this building. We had to talk to the students in November, and a lot of them were worried then.
Many kids are separated from relatives who traveled to the Middle East and now could have trouble coming back. Muhammad Alawi's parents are in Yemen.
It might come to where all Muslims might get kicked out of America. You know, like my parents not coming back. That's what I'm scared of.
Refugees from Syria have come to Hamtramck, and the schools have worked to accommodate them. But Yemen is a war-torn country too. Add the travel ban, and that means more stress for some students like this girl, who doesn't want to be identified.
I think about people in Yemen and how they just hear bombings in other countries, how they hear bombings in the middle of the night, and I just get afraid. If Trump wants to get ISIS, they should go after them, not us.
Some of them have seen it firsthand. They were right in the thick of it, and they were able to escape. And now it's a situation where they're not able to really escape truly, because now it's another issue. They escape one major issue, and now it's another issue.
As of now, no one has approached Hamtramck schools looking for immigration information. But if that happens, there's a procedure in place.
What would your plan be if the government actually came to the school and asked for their information?
First thing I would do, I would call the district attorney and find out exactly what I have to do, what I should do, or what I can do, or what I can't do. And I will follow the advice of the attorney.
First, you will need seeds, said Squirrel.
It's not clear what would happen if the government were to withhold funds to get its way. But nationwide, other schools and universities have taken positions just like Hamtramck's Safe Haven resolution.
Thinking ahead, this can be something that other districts can use and shorten their process.
Yeah.
You know, if they wanted to adopt something like this, this can be the model. We're more than willing to let them adopt it and use this model. The work is done.
For the Arab American News and Detroit Journalism Cooperative, I'm Hassan Khalifa reporting.
Okay, Ann Arbor schools and the University of Michigan have adopted similar safe haven resolutions, and the topic came up this week during a Detroit Public Schools Community District Board meeting at Western International High School, which was recently designated a sanctuary school. Detroit Federation of Teachers President Ivy Bailey urged the board to make all Detroit schools sanctuary. So, Nolan, are we living in a time where these safe havens are necessary?
No, I haven't heard any hint that the administration or anybody else is going to go into schools and start dragging out school children. I don't think that's going to happen. I don't think we serve these children very well by putting that impression in their head. You heard the one young fellow say, gosh, they're going to throw all Muslims out of America. I think that sort of promulgating that sort of fear and idea is unrealistic. I don't think it's going to happen.
Well, that's what the president is saying. I mean, the president has said this is a Muslim ban. He said it all during the campaign. He has said it several times since he was elected, before he was sworn in, though, that he feels like he's got to put a stop to Muslim immigration into this country to, as he says, figure out what's going on.
But that's not at all what he did. I didn't support the way he handled this immigration ban. But I was on a panel this past weekend with Osama Sablani from the Arab American News, and he told the audience, he says, God, thank God for Donald Trump. And what he meant was, until Donald Trump come along and started saying these things, nobody was paying attention what was happening in regards to immigration and crackdowns on the Muslim community. That's been going on for 8 years.
Right.
He was highly critical of the Obama administration policies, much of which he said mimicked the travel bans that Trump put in place.
They didn't mimic.
Also the terror watch list, which traps a lot of young people.
Terror watch list is worse,
And the no-fly list, which kids like this end up on for no good reasons. I've been writing about that for years, but all of a sudden now that it shift to a new administration doing these things, an administration that, you know, is not
well-received
on the left.
It's a racist administration.
You're starting to hear about this, and you're getting, you know, Muslims are suddenly being embraced, but they've been under this sort of pressure for eight solid years.
So there's a difference between there's a difference between extreme vetting of Muslim immigrants, which doesn't just date back to the Obama administration. It dates back to the administration of George W. Bush following 9/11 and the two wars. But there's a huge difference between that and what is going on now, which is a ban on travel from those seven countries, which has
We
haven't had those bans before, except in times of exigency. In other words, if something happens, if there's a credible threat that they perceive from those countries, you stop immigration from them while you figure it out. What's the credible threat that Donald Trump perceives? It's just in his mind. I mean, he's offered absolutely no justification. So that's one difference. The other difference is this has been extended to people who have immigrated here legally. So green card holders are being told at the airport, hey, maybe you may not be able to come in. I mean, to compare that to what the president did, the former president did, which was to identify countries where it was difficult to get information about immigrants, and they needed to take more time in order to do that. It's apples and anvils.
But what the former president did is allow this terror watch list to grow to tens.
That's a different issue, right?
It's the same issue. Yeah. It's how we treat Muslims and immigrants. And he allowed that to grow to tens of thousands of people without due process. People got on that list without due process. And you didn't see, you know, folks bringing Muslims onto the stage at the Grammy Award saying this was wrong. This has gone on for a long time, and nobody seemed to care because it was a Democratic president doing it.
That's not true. I mean, Democrats in the House talked incessantly about the terror watch list and trying to fix it. Well, I mean, they don't have the majority.
What did the president do?
Didn't have the majority.
These were the president's.
They were
policies.
Trying to pressure the president and the security community
You have Republicans trying to do the same thing to Trump. What I'm saying is that this is not some brand new day where we went from a country that was welcoming to Muslims to one that wasn't. I mean, we have denied due process.
And you don't attach anything to the rhetoric. You don't attach anything racist nature of this.
I think it's harmful and damaging, but it didn't just start with Donald Trump.
Well, I don't think anyone's saying it started with Donald Trump. It heightened, it intensified when this president took office and within hours signed an executive order that said, we're going to keep people out on the basis of their, basically on the basis of their religion.
Well, what he said on the basis of the activity that's going on in their country. I don't support this travel ban. I thought it was ham-handed, but I'm not going to sit here and pretend that we haven't been doing things like that for a decade or more.
Well, but this is sort of the typical Republican response to everything. Mm-hmm. Every criticism is, well, Democrats do it too, and that's not true.
No, it's
a very big distinction. It is a big distinction between what this president
did all that,
and what George W.
It's not
W.
all that. I think it exposes his hypocrisy of the left. As long as it's their guy doing it, they stay quiet. And then as soon as it's not their guy, they notice the problem.
John Conyers.
And we see that on
John
the erosion
Conyers,
of civil rights.
Debbie Dingell,
over this last
Carl
decade.
Levin. I mean, name a Democrat in Michigan who was quiet about the problems with the terror watch list.
They all were. Those watch lists, which I think are equally egregious because it denies due process.
It does.
And because anybody could end up with them and you can't get off. Did you see these folks leading big protests?
No, they were leading protests in the House where they were trying to get Congress to do what they were supposed to do, which was to address the issue.
It was their president, and they seemed to have no influence on it.
I'm not sure I agree with the hypocrisy.
Of course you don't.
We got to move on. All right, a quick follow-up now on a story we've been following here on My Week. The mother of Eastern Michigan University student M. Bakir Mohi Eldin returned home to Detroit late last week. She'd been visiting relatives in Iraq. but was unable to get home because of the President Trump's executive order on immigration. She is just weeks away from becoming an American citizen. Now, turning to the loss of Detroit icon Mike Ilitch. Detroiters are paying their respects this week to the founder of Little Caesars Pizza and owner of the Detroit Tigers and the Red Wings. Ilitch leaves behind a legacy that has literally changed the landscape of Detroit and provided jobs and hope for thousands. His latest contributions include the District Detroit development and a business school named after him at Wayne State University. He truly was a champion for the city. Of course, though, there's always more than one side.
There always is, of course, stories, to anyone. Right? But I tell you, Steve, the first pizza I ever ate when we came up here from Kentucky was out of that garden, that first Garden City Little Caesars Pizza Treat shop. And my first date in high school was to the Little Caesar sort of restaurant they had in Garden
really?
City.
So look at that.
Little
You're
Caesar's
all tied
pizza.
Up with the Ilitch legacy.
Sure am. But yeah, you know, there's always. I mean, nobody is all one way or all the other. And, of course, the Ilitches came under criticism for a long time in Detroit for buying up property and then sitting on it. But
I mean, they were speculators in some way, right?
In a lot of ways. But you look where it's come to. And I think this district that they've taken this land they've accumulated over all these years and have built this mixed-use plan for around the new arena, when that comes to fruition, It's going to change Detroit into a city we haven't seen probably since the 1960s.
Yeah. Well, it's going to I feel like it's going to sew together
all those
the things that we've seen happen in Midtown and the stuff that we've seen happen downtown. You've always had this sort of donut hole around the freeway and a little bit north that no one was quite sure what to do with, partially because the Ilitches held a lot of that land and were not doing anything with it. But it is. They deserve a lot of credit for that vision. You know, I've had my differences with the organization over the amount of public subsidy that we've had go into their projects. Also, the disappointment really that I think 20 years later surrounds some of the development of Comerica Park. I mean, I can remember sitting at City Council in 1994 and watching the Ilitches. Unveil what looked like the same photos that they trotted out for this district, Detroit, talking about what would happen around Comerica Park. We never quite got there.
But the difference is they didn't control much of that land, and this is a different era
than it was then.
Right. There is an appetite now for development. You think about what Detroit was like in 1989 when he moved downtown.
When
he moved in, he passed a whole lot of people who were moving out. Detroit was not then what it is
really
today,
true.
And the belief, the sort of confidence in the city's future wasn't there. This was as bold a move as anyone has made in terms of staking a bet on Detroit's future. They had no reason to believe we were going to get to this point, and yet Mike Ilitch did believe that.
So what do you think changes now that, I guess, Chris Ilitch, his son, is going to control the entire organization? He already had at least nominal control of it anyway. He's been the face of the organization for years.
Do we
see a different direction?
No, you know, we don't talk enough about the role of Mary Ilitch in this company, and she was a full partner with Mike in running every aspect of these businesses. And so I don't see any direction change because she's still there and Chris is still there, and I think they share a vision. It's not a company run by folks outside the family. It's a family-run business.
Yeah.
And I think the family will continue its commitment. I think they're very excited about bringing this district to fruition.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't know that they're done here.
I think the investment in the business school at Wayne, which has gotten some attention, but I think people haven't come to fully appreciate how big a deal that is to create that, where it's going to go, and to raise the profile of a pretty important college at the university, that one that we don't otherwise really think of as contributing so much to the city.
And fill a need in Detroit in terms of business education and developing a future generation of business people here.
Yeah. And of course, it'll be a lot of fun once it's open. I was saying to my son that we went to a Pistons game out in Auburn Hills last week. I said it's our second to last game that'll be out there. Next fall, we'll be able to walk two Pistons games.
There you go.
And I will be one of the people with my money in my hand.
And your big horn blowing out on the street.
That's right.
You know, I wrote the other day, I think they should name it the Mike Ilitch Arena.
His I wonder impact, why they didn't do that.
You know, they still may. I mean, he might not have allowed that while he was living, but, you know, the impact he's had on the city and certainly on that organization. We talk a lot about his development roles and sports roles, but the Little Caesars Pizza Company is a major corporation and very innovative. They're $5
that hot and ready saved the company
and really was is just one of the most popular things.
The kids like that too. I'm not as big a fan of that, but it did save.
Oh, I love the hot and ready.
That matters. All right, and finally tonight, President Trump has a vacancy to fill after the White House National Security Advisor Michael Flynn stepped down. His resignation comes amid reports that he discussed U.S. sanctions on Russia with the Russian ambassador to the United States prior to the president taking office. Now, some Republicans are warming up to the idea of a Flynn investigation. And, of course, calling it a Flynn investigation, I think, understates what's going on here. I think there is an increased appetite to figure out what the relationship is. What is the real relationship between Donald Trump and the people around him and the Russian government?
And bigger than that, I mean, what is the role in Russia in meddling in our government and in our elections? That's what Mitch McConnell said the other day. He said, we don't want a Michael Flynn investigation. We want a Russia investigation of all of these allegations. We've got to settle and put this Russia business to rest. We've got to know exactly what happened so that we can have, so that people can have trust and put an end to, you know, a lot of the conspiracy theories or, you know, verify them. I don't know what's true or what's not, but I think we need to do two things. We need to find out the role of members of the Trump campaign and others in working with Russia. It's inappropriate, it's unacceptable, whether you're from the right to left. We also have to figure out what's going on in the intelligence community, because you cannot have your intelligence community spying on private citizens and then leaking the information to destroy their careers. That's a police state. We can't have that either.
I feel like the intelligence community is in a really weird spot, okay? So their job is to keep track of all of these kinds of machinations, whether they involve private citizens or government operatives. Their job is also, though, to keep that information secret for national security purposes. But when the things that people are doing who are inside the government also seem to implicate or threaten national security, if you're in the intelligence community, I mean, it's sort of a mind scramble. What's the proper role for making sure that you're doing your job?
Well, I think that's assigning them too much credit. I think in this case, you had a community at odds with the administration,
new
president, and went rogue. And it's not the first time the intelligence community has been increasingly going rogue over the last decade or so. That community's got to be brought into line.
Who gets to do that? How do you do that if they have no faith in the president, which they clearly don't? Who's the person who whips that into shape?
Well, I mean, the president has to. He's got to put people in place, and the new director of the CIA and other intelligence officials have to go through that agency and root out subversives.
Yeah.
That's not their role, and it's not appropriate, and you absolutely cannot spy on private American citizens without a warrant, and I haven't seen a warrant in this case.
That's some of the unknown here. How did they get to the place where they were spying? And were there others, right? Were they listening to
Who
other
else
conversations?
Did they listen to?
I suspect that this was part of a pretty major operation that involved not just Flynn, but several other people in this administration, and trying to figure out what role they were playing.
So did they go to
the FISA court? Right.
And if they didn't, then we need to know.
Then a lot of people are in trouble too.
Exactly.
I have a hard time imagining who would take this job as national security advisor at this point, given that tension that we were just talking about, that the intelligence community is not wild about this this administration, mm-hmm. and the administration not wild about the intern.
Somebody will take it. I mean, it's an important job, and people want to serve their country, and so
I think
it'll be filled, and hopefully we can move on.
Yeah. But. Well, I mean, moving on is something I think we're not going to be able to do anytime soon, and part of that is the president's fault. I mean, like Nixon, and there aren't a number of parallels to this, but like Nixon, he's been very slow at divulging things mm-hmm. that would probably wipe all this away.
And so, you know, I think he's got to end the chaos in his administration. We've got to get moving. He's got to end the chaos. The Democrats have got to end their resistance, and we got to start moving on behalf of this country. Yeah. We're going to be in trouble.
All right, that's it for My Week. Thanks for spending time with us. Check out myweek.org and follow us on Twitter and Facebook. Christy will be back next week. We'll see you next time.
Did you know? Roush Enterprises was selected by Google to assemble a test fleet of 100 prototype self-driving cars in 2015. It also produced the new Domino's delivery cars. And speaking of Domino's, Domino's sells well over 2 million pizzas per day around the world, and half of their sales are digital. These are just some of the ways Michigan's pioneers started out as small companies with big ideas.
We are business leaders for Michigan. We are committed to making Michigan a top 10 state for jobs, personal income, and a healthy economy. Funding is also provided by Delta.